Good day, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us today. My name is Donna Jensen, and I'm a portfolio manager for the Middle East North Africa region at the International Federation of Accountants. I'd like to begin with some housekeeping. So let's move to the next slide. First, interpretation information. Please note that there will be simultaneous interpretation provided in both Arabic and English. At the bottom of your screens, you'll need to choose either Arabic for Arabic language or English for English language. So we'll move to the next slide. So since we're using the Zoom webinar, you have to put your questions in the questions and answers box. So please take a moment to locate that on your screen. And during the presentations at any time, we encourage you to please put your questions in the box and we'll respond to them. So also note that all attendees, their microphones are automatically muted. So your videos will be also automatically turned off. And this event, as you know, will be available in both English and Arabic and is being recorded. So after this event, we'll post it on the IFAC website. Over to the next slide. So what you see on your screens are two frequently asked questions. We want you to note that all attendees will receive an automated confirmation of attendance through Zoom by one day after the event. And if the email is not received, make sure to check your spam folders or junk mail. For those of you who are interested in this counting towards your CPD requirements, please make sure to contact your local professional accountancy organization. And we'd also like to highlight that all registrants will receive a copy of the presentation slides again after the webinar. So we'll move over to the next slide. With that, I'd like to welcome and hand over the mic to our moderator for this event, Mr. Hatem Kawasmy, Chairman of the Arab Federation of Accountants and Auditors. Mr. Kawasmy is also managing partner of KPMG Jordan and ex-chairman of the Jordanian Association of Certified Public Accountants. He has over 30 years of experience in senior management, advisory services, assurance, and tax consultancy. Mr. Kawasmy is also an expert IFRS, expert trainer on IFRS and finance topics for more than 20 years. So over to you, Mr. Kawasmy, and thank you very much.
Thank you, Dana.
I'd like to draw your attention to the fact that the number of participants who have registered for this webinar is around 600. The title of our webinar is State-Owned Enterprises and Professional Accountancy Organizations in Public Financial Management Reform, the Recovery Post-COVID. Allow me first to thank His Excellency, the Minister of Finance of Egypt, Dr. Mohammed Mo'id, and Her Excellency, the Minister of Economic Planning in Egypt, Dr. Hala Hilmi Assaid, and His Excellency, Mr. Ma'ali Mohammed, the head of the Arab Economic Unity, who have supported this webinar. I would like to thank them on behalf of the IFAC, the AFAA, and the World Bank. And a brief overview about the AFAA. It's an accredited body and a very effective entity that was founded in 1970, and it has a great vision, which is to integrate the efforts and initiatives of its members to advance the accounting and auditing profession in the region to support economic development. So AFAA is the Arab Accountants and Auditors Federation is considered an accredited union for all Arab countries by the Council of Arab for the Council of Arab Economic Unity, and the AFAA members include 16 professional accountancy organizations, 8 of which are members of the IFAC.
أفراد لدى اتحاد المحاسبين
with more than 2,532 individual members as of 2019 records. So they are from all over the Middle East and North Africa. So I would like to thank all the sponsors, the IFAC, the World Bank, and the Arab Federation of Accountants and Auditors for organizing this this conference. And we have an elite of speakers who are very competent, very experienced, and who will be tackling the issues of SOEs and PFM reforms, especially in the post-COVID recovery phase. Next slide. So this is the agenda of our meeting. First, we will start with the topic of supporting the global accountancy reform agenda. So we have Laura Leka from the public sector. We have Rajat Narula from the World Bank. I will be presenting their bio in a few minutes. And then we will have Mr. Jens Kristensen from the World Bank, who will be talking about the PFM reform from the SOE perspective. Afterwards, we will have Mr. Jamal Milhem from the IFAC, who will be speaking in Arabic and who will talk about the PFM reform from the PAO perspective. And then we will have a panel discussion, and we will open the floor for questions and answers. This is when we'll be answering the participants' questions. And during this discussion, we will have all the participants, in addition to our colleague, Alex Metcalf, who is the Global Head of Public Sector at the ACCA, the Association of Chartered Certified Accountants. Next slide, please. As I mentioned earlier, we will have our colleague Alex Metcalf.
يكون Alex في الجلسة النقاشية في ختام هذا هاي ورشة العمل. طبعاً الجدير ذكروا إنه Mr. Alex is the global head of public sector at ACCA. And also, he is leading ACCA's global public sector and oversees its public sector research and thought leadership. Also, Alex represents ACCA with key contacts in the public sector, including policymaker within government and international organization, in order to share good practices and insights in public financial management and to work together in the public interest. Prior to ACCA, Alex has worked across central and local government in the UK and Canadian civil service, including as a senior economist specializing in tax policy at the Ontario Ministry of Finance. He has published material across a health of public sector topics, including infrastructure finance, employment law, physical policy, immigration, and skills. This is a brief about Alex CV. Next, please. Now our first speaker or presenter will be our colleague Laura Leka. She will speak about supporting greater transparency and accountability in the public sector. Laura is a principal in IFAC's thought leadership team, focusing on initiatives in support of finance and accounting professionals working in business and the public sector. She was previously an audit manager at Grant Thornton, specializing in public sector audit in the UK, and prior to that, worked for the Audit Commission. She also spent a year on secondment to the International Integrated Reporting Council, IRRC. IIRC, where she was responsible for managing their public sector and business network programs. Laura is a member of the Chartered Institute of Public Finance and Accountancy, CIPFA, and holds a Bachelor of Science degree in Mathematical Physics from the University of Nottingham, UK. Please join me welcoming Laura. Laura, floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Hatem, for the introduction. And good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. It is a pleasure to participate on today's webinar, and I would like to thank AFAA, the World Bank, and my colleagues at IFAC for organizing this event. To start off this session, I will be sharing a brief overview of IFAC's activities and initiatives at an international level to support greater transparency and accountability in the public sector. So if you could go on to the next slide, please. So starting on the policy and advocacy side, so amid the global health crisis, the climate emergency, the need to restore economic growth and ensure a sustainable, equitable and inclusive recovery, interest in the public sector and strong public financial management continues to grow, as does the demand for greater transparency and accountability. This is an area of high priority for IFAC. It features in our annual G20 call to action. And last month, IFAC released its latest point of view, greater transparency and accountability in the public sector. And this is currently available on our website in English and in Arabic. And it outlines how IFAC believes the public sector can achieve the strong financial management necessary to build a prosperous future for us all. And importantly, it specifies the necessary role that the accountancy profession plays. So it's split into three parts that you see on the slide here. So the first part is strong governance and public financial management, which is absolutely fundamental to ensure that governments and public sector entities around the world make better, more informed decisions for people, the planet, and the economy. And a key element of this is high quality global public sector accounting standards, and in particular, the accrual basis international public sector accounting standards, the IPSAS. And I will come back to those later on in my presentation. The second part is the key role of the accountancy profession in the public sector. And that includes professional accountancy organizations, the PAOs, as well as individual accountants working within public sector entities. And I know Jamal, Milhem from IFAC's PAO Development and Advisory Group will be covering the PAO role in supporting PFM reforms later in this webinar. And then the third and final part is preparing for 2030. And strong PFM is an essential foundation for governments to make the difficult decisions necessary to balance the many post-pandemic priorities and delivery of the Sustainable Development Goals, all while ensuring long-term financial resilience and ongoing public service delivery. And this section also highlights the importance of broader performance measurement and reporting to understand the impact of spending on social value and outcomes, so going beyond the financials only. And if we could go to the next slide, please. Next, looking to COVID-19 recovery. And to explore the strategic priorities and challenges as the world's governments advance from crisis response to recovery, IFAC hosted a global roundtable earlier this year. And the event brought together senior public finance professionals from across central and local governments, the health sector, and supreme audit institutions, as well as members of the IPSAS-B and PAO staff. And among the participants were public sector members of IFAC's board and IFAC's Professional Accountants and Business Advisory Group. And the key messages from this event are summarized in the report referenced here, and this is available on the IFAC website. So I won't go through all of them, but I would just like to highlight a clear sentiment throughout the event and the discussion was that accountants have been and must continue to be at the heart of the COVID-19 response, playing a central role in helping governments and public sector organizations make tough choices, innovate, do more with less, and importantly, reinforce trust in public services and spending. If we could go to the next slide, please. And I want to move on to IFAC's activities in support of IPSAS adoption and implementation. And I will briefly cover each of the four main projects listed here. So we have the COVID-19 intervention assessment tool, the recent update to the International Public Sector Accountability Index. We have IPSAS Train the Trainer course materials and upcoming guidance on pathways to accrual. So next slide, please. So the COVID-19 intervention assessment tool. The world's governments must advance from crisis response to recovery with sustainable fiscal programs that are affordable over the long term. And to help governments understand the impact of interventions, IFAC and the Zurich University of Applied Sciences, in partnership with the IPSAS-B, created this COVID-19 intervention assessment tool. It provides an immediate way of evaluating the economic impacts of current and planned policy initiatives and interventions, including, very importantly, the impact on the balance sheet. Recognizing that full implementation of accrual-based accounting and reporting is still a longer-term endeavor for many governments, this tool can be used independently of any given jurisdiction's public sector accounting basis. Next slide, please. So the International Public Sector Accountability Index. The index was first compiled by SIPFA and IFAC in 2018 to understand the global picture in terms of public sector financial reporting. And to monitor progress, it has been recently updated with 2020 actual data, as well as 2025 forecasts and 2030 projections. The headline is that 30% of the 165 jurisdictions in the index reported on accrual in their 2020 financial statements, which is an increase of 6% compared to 2018. The index also shows a positive rising trend that in 2025, the forecast is an increase to 50% using accrual. Then looking ahead to 2030, the current projection is 73%. Although this is subject to more uncertainty, particularly in the current environment where reform programs may be impacted by the pandemic. And then alongside the move to accrual, the index also looks at financial reporting frameworks and the extent to which IPSAS are being used. And that's either directly with no modifications, indirectly with modifications for local context, or as a reference to develop national standards. And the trend in IPSAS usage and influence is also positive. In 2020, of those reporting on accrual, 57% are using IPSAS. In 2025, that increases to 73%. And by 2030, the current projection is 81%. So this is positive because as well as needing accrual reporting across jurisdictions, it's also important to have that comparability across jurisdictions. Next slide, please. IPSAS Train the Trainer course materials. So just to make clear, IFAC does not provide certifications or continuing professional development. So the intention with these materials is to make them available for free for non-commercial use so that IFAC's members, the professional accountancy organizations, and other stakeholders and partners can use them for training in their own jurisdictions and update them where necessary to incorporate country-specific requirements or considerations. The material is intended to assist governments and government organizations currently on a cash basis or a near cash or a modified cash basis of accounting and in the process of transitioning to accrual IPSAS. There are 10 modules in total, and each has a training manual and a set of accompanying slide decks. And these include notes for the trainer. Each module is broken down into a series of topics that are as far as possible standalone, so they can be delivered as individual sessions, and presenters and trainers can pick and choose which topics to focus on, which ones are more relevant, and in what order to run sessions. And this is just an example on the slide of one of the modules. So this is the expenses module, and this includes three topics. You have social benefits, collective and individual services, and IPSASB proposals for transfer expenses. And they have been developed with students in mind. So they include practical examples, there are review questions to test understanding, and they can be used for either in-person or virtual training sessions. Next slide, please. And finally, the project Pathways to Accrual. This is an update to the Study 14 guidance that was published back in 2010. It has been renamed Pathways to Accrual, and we're currently working with SIPFA to update the content to make it more practical, with a discussion of various transition paths to accrual, identifications of the main tasks and issues and other considerations, and importantly, case study examples. The updated guidance will be incorporated into an online platform to make it easier to navigate than the previous PDF document. And this will also allow other relevant resources to be referenced and linked. And once it is live later this year, the intention is that over time, additional examples will be added to help illustrate how practical challenges in initiating and managing an accrual implementation program have been overcome. And if you could go to the next slide. And lastly, this is a further resource from the ACCA and IFAC. It's called Is Cash Still King? Maximizing the Benefits of a Transition to Accruals. And it looks at the lessons learned from jurisdictions that have implemented accruals. And the author of this report, Alex Metcalf, is kindly joining the Q&A panel session later in the webinar, and I'm sure can share further insights then. So I will finish there and hand back over to Hatem, but very happy to take any questions once we get to the Q&A session later in the webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, Laura. Shukran, Laura, ala hay المعلومات القيمة والجهود واضحة.
Thank you, Laura, for these valuable information. IFAC's efforts are in supporting the public sector in moving from the cash to the accruals are very obvious.
وهي تساهم في مساعدة جميع الدول في العالم.
I would like to thank you for these efforts in supporting all the jurisdictions in moving to accruals. Thank you again, Laura. And now, our speaker is Mr. Rajat Narula.
راح يتحدث عن دور البنك الدولي.
Rajat will talk about the role of the World Bank.
Mr. Rajat is a lead financial management specialist in Middle East and North Africa, MENA region. Work with the World Bank's governance global practice and has been with the bank for over than 23 years. Having previously worked in South Asia and East Asia regions of the bank, he is a chartered accountant also and a certified internal auditor. Besides supporting public financial management reforms and fiduciary assurance issues in MENA region, he also chairs World Bank's public expenditure and financial management community of practice. Over to you, Mr. Rajat. Thank you.
Thank you, Hatem, for the introduction, and good morning and good afternoon to all the participants. The World Bank is really pleased to be a part of this webinar, and we are very, very happy welcoming you all. So continuing with the theme of global support for public sector accounting and financial reporting, in the next 10, 12 minutes, what I'll do is I'll cover how does the World Bank support the public sector accounting and financial reporting. Next slide, please. Just to lay out the context, so the World Bank strongly supports the use of public sector accrual accounting based on international standard because it allows the governments to provide a comprehensive overview of their financial position and performance. It facilitates external oversight of public expenditure and thereby boost trust in government. It also provides reliable financial statistics and helps governments manage fiscal risks better. World Bank's support for accounting reform is tied with our overall objective of strengthening country public financial management systems to ensure that the public resources are used effectively. Next slide, please. COVID-19 has certainly underlined the whole issue of accountability and transparency. In a 2020 report of IMF, the global fiscal support is estimated to have reached $14 trillion. So the need for greater transparency and the greater accountability in public spending is now even more urgent than it has ever been before. Next slide, please. So how does the World Bank actually support the accounting reform agenda globally? So there are three distinct windows through which we function. We have global and regional partnerships. We carry out diagnostic work. We do advocacy for the reforms. And we also carry out direct technical assistance. So what I'll do is to cover each of these windows and give you a bit of flavor in terms of what the World Bank is. Next slide, please. So in terms of global partnership, IPSAS-B is our most important partner. We work very closely with IPSAS-B in promoting and supporting network-based IPSAS. World Bank is also a standing member of Public Interest Committee, PIC, of IPSAS-B, and the remit of PIC is to provide assurance that the IPSAS-B standard-setting activities are in public interest. World Bank is also represented on the consultative advisory group that provides inputs on IPSAS-B strategy, work program, and project. Next slide, please. In terms of regional partnerships, we have in many regions certain platforms which have been created that we support. For example, in Europe and Central Asia, we have what is called PULSA, which is Public Sector Accounting and Reporting Program. In Latin America, we have FOCAL, and in North Africa, we have FACE. So these are some of the platforms that support public sector accounting and reporting, and the World Bank works with these regional platforms and supports them. Now, the support is provided through diagnostic assessments, through capacity building targeted at public sector accountants, and a variety of other stakeholders. Next slide, please. Now, in terms of diagnostics, the most important of diagnostic instrument that we use to measure the performance of public sector accounting is called Public Expenditure and Financial Accountability, PIFA assessment. So PIFA is a framework which, using quantitative indicators, measures the strengths and weaknesses of public financial management systems of a client. And PIFA has three indicators which are dedicated entirely to accounting and reporting systems. These are financial data integrity, in-year budget reports, and annual financial reports. One of the reports that we recently prepared in 2020, which talks about the public financial management reforms based on PIFA reports globally, identifies that while the countries have done well on data integrity, they haven't done very well on in-year budget reports and annual financial report. And so there is considerable scope of improvement on working on these issues. Now, banks, dialogues, and PFM, bank has engagement at the country level with many client countries on a PFM dialogue, the public financial management dialogue. And we use this opportunity to also promote a discussion on public sector accounting reforms and engage the governments on those debates. Next slide, please. Technical assistance. We also provide direct technical assistance to projects in different countries. Recently, we carried out a study which identified about 89 donor-led technical assistance projects that have an accounting or financial reporting component. About a third of these projects were World Bank-funded projects. These projects have multiple components, have a multi-year time horizon, and the range of activities that is supported is also fairly broad. So you have education accounting curricula, you have training and capacity building, legal framework, standard setting, IT, strategy, policy dialogue, awareness raising, scoping assessment work. So there's a fairly broad range of the activities that these projects actually support. Next slide, please. Just to give you a bit of an example of what these technical assistance projects look like, in particularly bringing out the examples that we have in MENA region, in Morocco and Tunisia, using the FACE platform that I earlier mentioned, we have a program which supports accounting technician program that includes adoption of competency framework, training of trainers, and equipping the national PAOs. In Tunisia, we are supporting the government in preparation of national standards, preparation of implementation tools, and also capacity development. In Lebanon, we recently carried out training on IPSAS adoption for MOF and auditors. So just to give you a few examples on what the World Bank does in terms of technical assistance projects. Next slide, please. I also thought it would be useful to talk a little bit about what are the lessons learned here in terms of the World Bank support to PSA reforms. There is a lot of literature on this, so obviously we can't cover everything here, but I think three or four key lessons that I thought were important I'm putting up here. One particular lesson is that the legislature has to be involved in any public sector account reform process, because the reform process are generally supported by legislative reform. So it's important that the legislature is in the loop on this. And we've also, one of the lessons we've learned is that the awareness raising activities, whether these are peer exchanges, study tours, training, they're also critical. Not only prior to the launch of a reform, but to ensure that there is interest in the stakeholders, but also as a supporting measure during implementation so that support is maintained and sustained. Another lesson that we have learned is that a comprehensive roadmap helps, because if you have a comprehensive roadmap, it sort of converges all the stakeholders on the reform agenda. They all know what's the point of departure, what's the timeline, what are the timeline targets from year to year. And as a result, this is helpful in terms of ensuring that everybody is on the same page. IT systems are very important, and they are at the center of public sector accounting reform and also require attention. Next slide, please. In terms of the way forward, how does it look like? I mean, what is the World Bank approach to public sector accounting reforms going to be going forward? We believe that there is a fairly large number of countries which are moving to accrual-based accounting. It has to be targets that there will be 65% of countries will be switching over to accrual basis of accounting by 2023. So the World Bank's support to the accounting agenda, the public sector accounting reform agenda, will certainly continue and even strengthen. But I think what will change is that there will be a focus on more integrated approach towards PFM. So there may not be many standalone projects supporting accounting and financial reporting, but there will be more integrated PFM projects, public financial management projects, of which accounting and financial reporting reforms would be an important part. We'll also look for more synergies with other developing partners. So one of the things that our recent report which I mentioned that which took a stock take of the current projects found out that there were some gaps and overlaps between the development partners. And I think this is something that we would going forward do it better. Also, based on the lessons learned from political economy, it's also likely that the scoping work prior to the launch of a reform may receive more attention. Because just to ensure that all the stakeholders have bought into the reform, so there are no issues once the reform is underway. So that's something that the scoping work will probably need a little bit more attention than it has received before. So I think I'll just stop here. The idea was to give you a little bit of a flavor in terms of what we do And also to reiterate that the World Bank continues to be a very strong supporter of public sector accounting reforms. And it's likely that this support will continue going forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Rajat. Shukran li hai alwaraqa alniqashiyya.
Thank you, Rajat, for this research paper. For this presentation. Our colleague Rajat Narula from the World Bank has explained the role of the World Bank in the PFM reform in the public sector and their support in implementing the IPSAS, the International Public Sector Accounting Standards. If you have any questions,
Q&A session,
we will have a Q&A session at the end, and you will be able to share your questions in the Q&A box. And now with our speaker, Mr. Jens Kristensen. Jens is a practice manager in the
Middle East and North Africa region. Jens will سوف يتحدث عن الإصلاح المالي والمتعلق في.
So Jens will talk about the financial reform from the SOE perspective.
Public sector governance and management, as well as fiduciary assurance of the World Bank portfolio in the region. He's a senior development professional with more than 20 years of experience in governance and in institutional reform through engagements at the Danish Ministry of Finance, the OECD, KPMG Risk Advisory Services, the PEFA Secretariat, and the World Bank Group. Jens has operational and analytical experience in fragile states and middle income countries in Europe and Central Asia. Also in East Asia and the Pacific, in sub-Saharan Africa, as well as with OECD countries and the MENA region. With that, I would like to ask Mr. Jens to start his presentation. Over to you, Jens.
Thank you very much, Hatem. Thank you very much to our co-organizers, fellow panelists, and not least the many participants who have decided to join us today. I have three key messages, and I'll share them up front and then detail them a little bit. Firstly, state-owned enterprises play a very important role in the economic and social economies and social contracts in most countries in MENA. They provide employment, they provide services, and in some countries, they are also part of the political settlement or the political equilibrium. So while some may argue that privatization of SOEs should remain on the agenda, that may not be realistic in many of the MENA countries and for most of the state-owned enterprises in the regions. So focus would have to turn to improving state-owned enterprise performance and reducing the damage that some of them do to the economies and the social contracts in the countries in which they operate. My second point is that while there are many technical production-related reforms that can be made to improve the performance of individual state-owned enterprises, governance reform is very important element, is a very important element in this regard. And these governance reforms should include critically public financial management of the SOEs, the interplay between the state-owned enterprises on one hand and the governments and public sectors on the other hand, as well as the financial management within the state-owned enterprises. The cornerstones should be transparency, accountability, and that, for the purposes of our discussion, brings to the center stage the dimensions of quality, of timeliness, of accessibility, and reliability of information to the public, both on performance and delivery and on financial performance. Now, the third point is that professional accountancy organizations can play important roles in promoting and implementing these reforms, very much along the lines of what Laura and Rajat talked about in their interventions. Actually, reforms may not be possible without the accountancy profession. So all the participants today and panelists, our good selves, are VIPs when it comes to improving the performance and the management within and of the state-owned enterprises in the region. We should work at the institutional level, at the professional level, and as stakeholders in the countries in which we operate and live our lives ourselves and with our families and friends. So these are my three key points. Let me detail them a little bit in the following minutes. Firstly, on the importance of state-owned enterprise reforms for economic transition and growth in MENA countries. SOEs play a significant role in public finance and the economy of most MENA countries. In fact, talking about fiscal consolidation, performance, growth, without talking about state-owned enterprises in the MENA region probably does not give the full picture. A major element of the picture will be missing. SOE employment accounts for up to 30% in MENA, 25% of GDP, and in some cases, up to 50% of total banking assets. SOEs contribute significantly to government revenues and are often concentrated in essential and strategic sectors. All of us living in the region know our water utility, telecommunications, other public utilities, and in the GCC and some of the other oil-producing countries in the region, we also have SOEs in natural resources, strategic infrastructure, agriculture, you name it. So it's a cornerstone of the economies and the societies we're working in. The social contract in MENA countries is often upheld by the employment and subsidized services offered through the state-owned enterprises. And in that sense, it makes the work on SOEs more political in addition to being technical, but it also makes it more interesting professionally and more important. But while SOEs play this important role in the social contract, it is increasingly seen as being broken or at least being challenged in many of the countries in which we live and work. Many of them are financially unsustainable. It is increasingly clear that SOEs cannot deliver all the jobs that are required to help our young populations graduate into the labor market, establish families, and have meaningful economic and social lives. And in some cases, services are not up to standards. And in MENA countries, it's no different than the rest of the world, where the public sectors, including state-owned enterprises, increasingly under pressure from citizens who see what is being delivered in other countries, in other regions, and by the private sector. So SOEs that are not delivering are putting, if you will, delivery and respect for the public sectors under pressure. Importantly, in some places, SOEs are also providing unfair competition to the private sector, both when it comes to, if you will, operating in the market for services and goods, but also for the labor markets. SOEs and definitely the public sector more generally tend to pay a premium on the labor market compared to what the private sector can offer, and that distorts that part of the market. I should say, and I think Laura put this and Rajat also mentioned this, that this agenda becomes all the more important in the context of the ongoing COVID epidemic and the hope that we will graduate to a post-COVID period of reconstruction and recovery. I must say, I may be one of those who are a little bit more, if you will, on the fence as to how quickly we will get to the recovery phase, because with the variants, we might well be and may well be in a period of sustained stress. But even more so, the issue of SOE unsustainability becomes more important with massive debt and fiscal liabilities, underperformance capture, et cetera, being built up. There's broad agreement that reforms are needed. The question is how to do it and where to start. The key challenges related to state-owned enterprises are caused by regulatory capture, et cetera. And these are all hard reforms that take a long time to be addressed. Increasingly, it is recognized that governance has to be at the center of reforms required for state-owned enterprises. Improved governance of SOEs has, as Rajat mentioned, it traditionally been part of a broader package of reform measures for SOEs. Others include market neutrality, fiscal and risk exposure, sector-specific issues. But there is now an increasing growing body of research pointing to good governance as precondition for successful and sustainable SOE reforms. And I can post some studies by the World Bank, the IMF, the IBRD, the OECD for that matter, pointing to this. So my first point was that we have to improve the performance of the state-owned enterprises to deliver jobs, services, and growth in the region, and frankly, also to maintain trust in government and rekindle the social contract. My second point is that many SOEs and PFM reforms are intertwined and mutually supportive. Because basic principles of good public financial management, or PFM, also applies to SOEs. We have to recognize that state-owned enterprises are established by the state. They have either been established using taxpayers' money explicitly or through guarantees or guarantee schemes. And this funding and the legal mandates, whether they're commercial or non-commercial, the operating gives the legislators and the public and other stakeholders a right to know how funds are used by SOEs. And to manage the fiscal risks arising from state-owned enterprises, our countries need to establish a strong framework to manage their finances and to ensure that the framework is implemented robustly. Rules need to be in place for pricing, charging of services, but also for accounting and reporting systems, for their audit and oversight, and for their internal governance. Regulatory provisions are required on financial reporting obligations. Information on SOEs definitely has to be included in budget documents and the consolidated financial accounts of the government. It has to be provisioned for strategic plans and annual financial plans, in-year financial reporting, and importantly, rules relating to borrowing and debt limits and the provision of government guarantees. SOE transparency and accountability measures are at the core of the reporting framework to ensure sound decision-making and fiscal management with transparency relating to quality, timeliness, accessibility, and reliability of the information and accountability, not only being internal accountability, but also external accountability in the form of an effective, independent external audit by professional audit firms or Supreme Court institutions. So all this to say that when we talk about improving SOE performance and addressing what could be called the problem of state-owned enterprises, we need to move away from not only entertaining a privatization debate, but to addressing the issue of good governance and good financial management and reporting and transparency around our SOEs, making sure that they add value to the societies in which we work. I'm almost out of time, but my last point echoing Laura really is that the professional accountancy organizations and each of us have a duty and a role to move this forward. As Rajat also said, to promote this and advocate, be an advocate for these reforms. At the institutional level, we need to strengthen the financial reporting frameworks. Complying with IFRS is demanding, and we do need to move that agenda forward by mandating and also using reports and reporting when it is available. At the professional and technical level, we need to strengthen the financial management capabilities. MENA is blessed with a very high level of capacity, with good educational systems, and plenty supply, but there is a need to augment the human resources within the SOEs to counter political appointees or government posting of staff without technical qualifications, etc. And finally, we do need to engage to advocate for these reforms. In closing, there's growing realization that SOE governance reforms are no longer just nice to have, they are need to have to rekindle the social contract and help our country's citizens and businesses recover from the impact of the ongoing COVID epidemic. With that, Hatem, over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Jens. This is very informative presentation. Shukran, Jens, على توضيح وبيان دور
Thank you, Jens, for this thorough explanation about the role of state-owned enterprises in the public reform. And I think that there are going to be many questions about your presentation and the final session. And now we move on to the next speaker. Mr. Jamal Milhem.
He's a member of IFAC, PAO Development Advisory Group. جمال ملحم مستر جمال راح يتحدث عن البابليك فاينانشال مانجمنت ريفورم الاصلاح المالي في او الاداري في الاداره الماليه في الحكومه من وجهه نظر المنظمات المهنيه ومن الجدير ذكره ان السيد جمال ملحم he joined the IFAC PO development and advisory group in January 2018 for the first term from 2018 until 2020. And he was re-elected for the second term from 2021 until 2023. Also, Jamal was nominated in 2018 by the International Arab Society of Certified Accountants and has been a member of the PAOD and AG since then. Mr. Milhem was also elected by the PAOD and AG as chair of the MENA working group. Also, Mr. Milhem is currently the executive director and partner of TAGI in Palestine, and a member of TAG Org Executive Management Council, also member of FOF and one of TAG Org firms with more than 100 offices worldwide. He has more than 28 years of experience in public accounting and advisory services in different countries in TAGI and TAG Org. In addition, Mr. Milhem has more than 7 years of experience in higher education in different universities in Palestine related to teaching and development of accounting education programs. Mr. Milhem also currently serves as the president of the Palestinian Association of Certified Public Accountants, PAIB. With that, over to you, Mr. Jamal. Jamal, we can't hear you. Maybe you are on mute.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim.
In the name of God, the merciful, the compassionate. Can you hear me? Thank you, Hatem, for this presentation, for this introduction, I mean. And I will talk about the PFM reform from the PAO perspective. So I will be speaking on behalf of the IFAC PAO Development Advisory Group. I would like to salute all the panelists and participants from all over the world. I thank you, Hatem, and I would like to thank the Arab Federation of Accountants and Auditors for its work in the MENA region. And I also thank the IFAC, especially the IFAC staff who have been working very hard for the success of this webinar, Diana Jensen, Vanessa, and also my fellow speakers, Laura, Rajat Narula, Jens Kristensen, in addition to Mr. Alex from the ACCA. And since the majority of the participants are from the MENA region and most of them are Arabic speakers, I was advised to speak in Arabic, and I would like to thank our interpreter, Mrs. Noor Al-Kotob. During my presentation, I will talk about the PAOs, the professional accountancy organizations in supporting the financial system in the public sector. As we all know, COVID-19 outbreak has put governments across the region under considerable pressure. As the governments were under the pressure of providing healthcare services and social benefits, and many economic aspects were put on hold. And all these challenges have led to difficulties and challenges for the governments to put the budgets, because the economic factors were not very clear. And it was also very difficult for them to operate in those difficult circumstances. And we are in the recovery phase, and we need to work together in this phase in order to guarantee the success of the financial work in the public sector. So as we already mentioned, we had weakness in internal controls and legislative oversight, but this should not become the norm. Those were exceptional circumstances, and we need to go back to regular financial management and processes, and we need to resume the work as usual in the public sector. So now is an opportune time to empower PAOs to support governments in the recovery phases. So in order to define the role of PAOs, and we all know that PAOs are an integral part of the national financial infrastructure. And the PAOs have a significant role and a great contribution in the financial infrastructure and in the economic and social development in their respective countries. So for the PAOs to play their roles, they need to work in the public interest. So they need to be the real indicator for institutional work. And they need to develop and produce capable and competent accountancy professional through training and empowering professionals. The third point is to promote and enforce strong professional and ethical standards. And the PAOs also need to do the necessary in order to further the quality of financial reporting through the review of professionals. And the PAOs are also a resource for governments, regulators, and other stakeholders as they provide the standards, the professional standards. So this is what the PAOs are required to do. In order to succeed in this task, the governments must also empower PAOs to undertake their core functions. So the governments need to support the PAOs in order to focus on their real objectives. So governments need to be strong supporters of PAOs in order to face any challenges in order to improve the public financial system. So if governments promote the capacities of PAOs, we will have great benefits for the economy, especially the capability of attracting FDIs, foreign direct investments, when the trust increases in financial reports. And this will also help promote growth and development of SMEs. For example, any good financial system will help SMEs have a good financial system, which would encourage them to further develop, and this will benefit the whole economy. This will also enhance the transparency and accountability. For example, transparency in publishing information to the public about the financial performance of the public sector or the state-owned enterprises. This increases accountability and also helps use the public resources wisely and efficiently. And this efficiency would improve the public services offered to citizens. Furthermore, the financial system can also benefit from increased trust in public projects financed by the government or financed by external donors or other governments. Next slide, please. So how can we help PAOs, public accountancy organization, in playing this role in the public sector? Of course, there are many ways, but for this session, we will focus on supporting the public sector accountancy. Although the PAOs can do other things, but we would like to talk first about the main challenges faced by public accountancy organization in fulfilling their duty. One of the factors we see in the MENA region, for example, are legislative obstacles. The PAOs in our region have worked on many levels to develop their role. For example, the establishment of syndicates that have legislations supporting their establishment. So these legislations enabled the PAOs to play a greater role in the public sector. Also, PAOs have established committees in the Ministry of Interior. So some PAOs lacked legislative support. And that weakened their supervision over their members and the enforcement of their code of ethics. So therefore, many PAOs are struggling to survive or are looking for ways to survive and are unable to play the efficient role they are supposed to do in supporting the public financial system. So this was an example of the legislative challenges. Another aspect about how we can leverage the knowledge gained through the development of systems of training, education, and preparation of accountancy professional and assisting members in transitioning from national to international standards and from cash to accruals and enhancing the capacity of the workforce in the public sector and enforcing discipline and quality control and investigation. As well as internal controls.
Mr. Jamal, sorry, على المقاطعة بقي لديك دقيقة.
Sorry to interrupt you, Mr. Jamal, but you have 2 minutes left. So I still have two quick slides. The slide entitled "Looking Ahead," please. So what do we have to do? Transparency and accountability depend on having a sound and trustworthy financial information. And PAOs can contribute to training and provide guidance in public reporting, but most of PAOs lack resources to play that role. So it is important to support PAOs to enable them to play that role and engage in the dialogue with the public sector in order to have a greater role in training and education in the public sector. So what do we have to do at the end? We need to work together in implementing a holistic approach for development, and a number of participants like anti-corruption entities have a role to play, but they don't But the importance of the role of auditors is not reflected well enough. So it's very important to engage auditors and PAOs and syndicates. So it's important to engage size and anti-corruption agencies and accountants and other professionals in order to strengthen the whole supply chain. And the IFAC actively supports the fight against corruption with many interventions, including the publication entitled The Accountancy Profession Playing a Positive Role in Tackling Corruption, and the publication entitled The International Framework Good Governance in the Public Sector. I'd like to thank you again, and excuse me if I have exceeded the time allowed for me. If you have any questions, I would be happy to answer them. I give you the floor, Mr. Hatem. Thank you, Mr. Milhem, for this valuable presentation in which you talked about the role of public professional accountancy organizations, PAOs, and their role in the public finance reform. And we strongly agree that PAOs have a very important role to play in our region, and we hope that the governments of the MENA region will support PAOs, and we hope that international organization will provide greater support for PAOs. And on this occasion, I would like to thank the World Bank and the IFAC for their continuous support to professional accountancy organizations in the MENA region. And I have witnessed through my modest experience a lot of support provided by the World Bank and the IFAC for these PAOs. I would like to thank all the panelists who have amazed us with their very precious information. And we move on now to the last part of our meeting, which is the Q&A session. First, I would like to thank all the speakers, and I invite them to join the session, which will end at 54 minutes. And I give the floor now to my colleague, Mr. Jens Kristensen.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much to our speakers. And just a reminder, everybody in this call can pose questions in the through the Q&A button at the bottom of the screen. Questions can be put forward in Arabic or English or Danish for that matter, and they will be translated and shared. And we already have some questions around programs in the MENA region to help governments in adopting and implementing IPSAS other than training. So this question is from Dr. Al-Zarouni from the UAE. The question is, if there is a program or project to help countries, especially in the MENA region, to help them in adopting and implementing IPSAS other than training. I mean, on-the-ground program, helping public sector in the region by taking them step by step towards such implementation. If not, I should propose having such a program. And then I've been working 16 years in this field, and I must say that adoption is hard, but doable. Implementation is a totally different matter. So I emphasize a lot with the question from the UAE. And I actually propose that we start with Dr. Hatem, then Laura, and then Rajat give a go from each of the three organizations. And then, and while we're here, please don't hold the questions back in the Q&A facility on the screen. So, Dr. Hatem.
Thank you, James. Shukran, Dr. Abdul Karim, Habibna Abu Ahmed.
Thank you, Dr. For this important question. We will open the floor to our colleagues from the World Bank and the IFAC, Rajat and Laura, to comment on this question. But let me clarify that at the Arab Federation of Accountants and Auditors, we are ready to collaborate with the World Bank and the IFAC in order to facilitate and train many PAOs and many of our fellow professional accountants on the IPSAS. So this is our vision at the AFA, and our colleague Abdul Karim, I would be honored to collaborate with your PAO in the UAE, a dear country to us, in promoting the implementation of IPSAS and moving to accruals. Thank you.
Thank you. Laura, would you like to come in here, or Alex, either one of you, maybe Laura?
Thank you, Jens. Yeah, happy to comment on this. And I think I also concur with your sentiment that actually implementation of IPSAS is a long-term endeavor for many. And I think it's there's a no one size fits all. And I think as IFAC, our role is very much on as a convener between PAOs, between governments, between development partners, you know, working on events such as this with the World Bank and AFA. And I think just in terms of having that global guidance and practical case study examples, I think is always helpful just to see how others and other jurisdictions have firstly what challenges they've experienced and how they've overcome these. I think that's important. I think it's also important to recognize that there will be a local context to any reform program, and that sometimes it's a case of making incremental improvements. So I think definitely more guidance in this area, and from IFAC's perspective, from an international level, just to share those best practices across jurisdictions. I don't know if Alex, you had anything also on that.
Sure. Thank you, Laura. And first, I'd like to say, though, thank you very much to the organizers, to AFA, IFAC, and the World Bank for convening this and for what's been already a very impressive session and being able to listen in as a panelist across today's conversation. To the question at hand, though, from our perspective at ACCA, so this is the Association of Chartered Certified Accountants, where we have a member and student body of around 67,000 members and students, so in the public sector in 179 countries. I think we're in a fairly unique position to work with bodies like IFAC and other international organizations to get that global picture on good practice. And I think an excellent example of that is actually in a piece that you mentioned, Laura, in Is Cash Still King, that collaboration that IFAC and ACCA undertook last year, where we can see from what is a really exceptional piece of work with yourselves and SIPFO, the index, we see around 40% of countries transitioning to accrual looking out to 2030. So this is very much a global trend. But what we did in this piece of work was we instead went to the jurisdictions who had completed the journey to accrual, and spoke to the public sector finance experts who were instrumental in implementing accrual accounting. So a really interesting exercise to then be able to collect, collate all those lessons and bring them together in this report on Is Cash Still King, and then share those with those who are on the journey. So I see that as definitely part of the solution here. And actually, just really to speak to the question where I very much took the point where education can't be the only component of this. And I think that's a really core message to share today. And one thing that did come through from our experts in the conversations in that research report was that really success in implementation of accrual, so not just in adoption, but full implementation, comes when it's part of a broader PFM reform package. So when you're thinking about your IFMIS, when you're thinking about your systems, when you're thinking about e-procurement as another example, it's not something that occurs in isolation, but something that's a much broader set of implementation. So I guess it doesn't make it easier, but something that hopefully we can work on collectively in working towards success. So thank you very much, Jens.
Thank you. And Rajat, I think you alluded to some of the same points in your presentation. Do you want to come in here?
Thanks, Jens. Sure. So just to reiterate what Alex said, I think in terms of it's likely that the public accounting sector and financial reforms would proceed better if they were integrated into overall public financial management reforms rather than a standalone piece. I think this has been our experience as well. Now, in the region, there are some projects currently underway. There is some work undergoing in Morocco and Tunisia. Tunisia particularly on drafting of the standards and their adoption and training related to that, and in Morocco as well on the accounting technician program. We also have a program currently underway in Saudi Arabia where there was a move from switching to cash to accrual, and we were providing a distinct quality assurance role. So the kingdom was developing its own standards, but we were providing a quality assurance role on those standards. So there are different avenues currently underway where we are providing support to this agenda. Now, there is a possibility of doing this on a regional basis. I think that was the original thought here. And I think this is something that we are also beginning to explore, whether there is a possibility of a regional platform, like I mentioned, that we have regional platforms in Europe and Central Asia, in Latin America, and we are currently looking at possibility of setting up such a regional platform for Middle East and North Africa region. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think both you, Rajat, and Jamal raised the issues of working with the legislative bodies, the importance of getting the regulatory framework in place, but also, and the question relates to how to do that, point one, and two, how to overcome resistance from governments who may not want more transparency. So we're dealing or dabbling into the issue of political economy. So maybe Jamal, your thoughts on how to go about this, and the same with you, Rajat, and any examples you have. I've worked with parliaments around the world and I've found them extremely difficult to work with. It's a different, and it's, when you come with a finance background, it's a different language, it's a different logic. You may find common ground with the public accounts committees, but beyond that, it's a little bit heavy going. So Jamal and Rajat, the easy questions to the two of you. And then we have a question on cost for Laura and benefits for Laura and Alex. Thank you. Over to you, Jamal. You are muted. Jamal, you are muted.
Thank you, Jens. Shukran.
Thank you, Jens, for your question from Mr. Ahmed Akram Asula and from Dr. Abdul Karim Azarouni regarding what PAOs can do in order to support governments in implementing the IPSAS. Of course, PAOs and syndicates have a lot to do. For example, the PAOs have to raise awareness of governments and decision makers about the importance of implementing such standards in the public sector and the impact of that on developing the public finance and the economy. The second point is the PAOs need to contribute in training and building the capacities of the public sector workforce who are concerned with these international standards and attracting other countries to implement and adopt and implement those standards and sharing these experiences and challenges with other countries and with local and provincial governments So sharing the challenges that could be faced in the implementation phase, and also encouraging the integration of those reforms in the education programs in universities in order to raise the standards or raise the awareness of future professionals about those standards. And Laura showcased some examples of resources that can be used for training on IPSAS, which can be offered to the public sector. Also, our colleague from the World Bank, Mr. Narula, talked about initiatives from the World Bank. So our role as PAOs is to join these initiatives and the local contacts and the local governments and decision makers. I would like to give you also an example from the Arab world as a kind of encouragement. One of the Arab PAOs have translated all the IPSAS to Arabic in order to facilitate the access to such information to the to Arabic speaking decision makers. They have also developed certificates in order to link the sector with professional acquainted with the IPSAS. And the third point is that there are manuals related to implementing IPSAS that help professionals implement those standards. Those manuals were originally issued in English, but they have been translated into Arabic and they are available. So all these information are available to the PAOs and can be provided to governments. So this is to answer the question related to what can PAOs do to support governments and encourage them implement IPSAS. Thank you.
Thank you, Jamal. I think, Rajat, if you could very briefly share your thoughts before we move on to first the cost issues and then the cost-benefit ratio, and then Hatem will talk about the next question. So, Rajat, briefly over to you.
Thanks, Ian. So, clearly, I completely agree with you that it is a major challenge engaging the legislatures. And yes, they speak a very different language than the technocrats do. So I think it's a different engagement altogether. I think the couple of suggestions that I do have is that A, early engagement. So prior to the launch of the reform, if we can have that dialogue with the legislature and build a support there, that helps. And then I think their continuous and sustained engagement. So whether it's during the implementation reform period as well. Whether it's again aligned with some of the incentives they have. Now, a little bit of an example would be Saudi Arabia, although, I mean, not legislature in that sense of the word, but then the accrual accounting agenda was a part of its Vision 2030 document. So if we have an advocacy done to an extent where the accounting reform becomes a key part of the government's public sector reform agenda, it definitely helps. So for us to have that interaction in Saudi Arabia is much easier because it was something that they really had resolved to do. So I think this is these are a few of the things I suppose we could do, but all said and done, legislators are hard to engage, no doubt about it.
Thank you, Rajat. Alex, you raised your hand, but let me propose that you combine your response. We had this question, all these increased standards, more demanding standards, do put a burden on professionals and state-owned enterprises and public entities. Do we know, can we document whether it is worth it?
in the sense. And that ties a little bit into the question of how do you engage with stakeholders like parliaments? Is this just a burden, or how do can you quantify the benefits? So Alex, Laura, I don't know how you would like to share the response between the two of you before we go to Hatem.
Yeah, thank you. Happy to start off on this one. Mm-hmm. And Alex, I'm sure, feel free to pitch in. Yeah, I think a big part of our advocacy work is about sort of socializing the benefits of a move to accrual. There's a lot out there on increased transparency, more informed decision making, better accountability. And I think I'd echo what Alex said in his comments previously, that it has to be part of a broader PFM reform program. And I think as a key message, that implementing accrual accounting, that's not the end goal. And it needs to be used as a means of supporting other objectives. And so, you know, minimizing fraud and corruption is one. And it's hard to quantify some of these things. And I think that's part of our challenge in our advocacy efforts. But actually, you know, minimizing fraud and corruption, more effectively managing public sector assets and liabilities, and better understanding, you know, I think that the benefits of a move to accrual, I think that's key. I think the view from IFAC is that this accrual information has to be used for as many purposes as possible. So it's not just about the financial reporting, you know, it's used in budgetary control and in sort of processes within the public sector entity. And perhaps I'll pass over to Alex on this point, because I know that was a key message from your research that you did, that actually it's not just the reporting.
Yeah, very much so, Laura. So thank you for that swift handover there on the research that we jointly undertook. And maybe just to start this off then, Jens, I think a really important facet of this common question that comes up around engaging legislatures and then the cost and benefit analysis is down to accepting that political reality. So accepting that, unfortunately, the benefits are harder to quantify compared to the costs, which will be comparatively easy. The case that we made in the research, though, was that, and I think this has become even stronger with COVID-19, that we're now in a position that we probably wouldn't want to talk with certain jurisdictions as much about transparency and accountability. I'd instead focus around decision useful information. I'd focus the case and the benefits around the fact that we get a fuller picture, a comprehensive picture through full accrual implementation. And you'll also see from another piece of work, which we undertook jointly with the governance team at the World Bank. It's called Sustainable Public Finances Through COVID-19. Looking at a particular snapshot of that time in 2020, most of the global interventions in response to COVID-19 were what economists describe as below the line interventions. So different forms of promises made by governments. And these promises are not well documented through our traditional debt to GDP ratios. Instead, what we need is that comprehensive view that's covered, where we have fiscal risks accounted for through accrual. And I think that's now the case, where we're coming to a place with the increasing debt burden, with the very difficult position we find our public finances in, that I think, unfortunately, we can't fool ourselves anymore either. Is the reality of it. And maybe that's a way that we need to talk to legislatures about this, is the fact that fiscal illusions, so having a different reality than what we present, isn't going to work in terms of our accounting boundaries, our timing of payments, and classification and recognition issues. I'd also point to some really exceptional research I saw from the IMF in this area to make the case, which is that they talk about net worth and the fact that in their analysis, governments and public sectors who have a strong net worth position face lower rates of interest on their public debt, and they also are better able to navigate through financial crises. So they have more resilience going through crisis. So I think these are the ways that we need to be talking about this and the information that's brought to bear, and doing our very best to try and articulate those benefits, Jens, which I appreciate can be harder to quantify, though, too.
I mean, one option is to see whether transparency is rewarded by lower interest rates on borrowing. Mm-hmm. That could be a fun thing to look at. Mm-hmm. Anyways, Hatem, we have a question from the Deputy Auditor General of Sudan, who is asking, does the Arab Federation of Accountants have any mechanisms in place to screen and check the Arab countries' members if they need any assistance, for example, in IFAC membership admission or in recognition of relevant standards, etc.? Or is this a country-owned effort? Over to you, Hatem.
Thanks, Yen. Shukran لهذا السؤال من.
Thank you, Jens, from this question for this question from our colleague from Sudan. And we're glad to answer this question. The AFAA, the Arab Federation of Accountants and the Auditors, has on several occasions with the IFAC helped many PAOs from our Arab world in joining the IFAC, becoming members of the IFAC. By providing support in providing the needed information and by endorsing them as sponsors. And our colleague Dana from IFAC was responsible for some of those projects related to some Arab PAOs. So to answer your question, yes, we can collaborate with Arab PAOs who would like to join the IFAC. We can help them through IFAC support. We can recommend them to IFAC and tell them that they deserve to become members as long as they don't have any big professional challenges that would hinder their membership. Thank you.
Thank you, Hatem. We have a few questions on the decade-old debate on cash versus accrual. Can you share with us, Hatem, your view on phasing and when a country should not move to accrual? I think the references are to different views of the IMF and the ongoing discussions, I guess, in the OECD Senior Budget Officials Group, etc. Hatem.
Yeah, thank you, Jens, for this. Actually, يعني هذا الموضوع موضوع هام وهو ساخن في منطقتنا موضوع التحول.
Thank you, Jens, for this question. This is a very hot topic in our region, the issue of moving from cash to accruals or implementing the IPSAS standards. I was member of one of the committees in Jordan that were responsible for moving the public sector from cash to accruals. First of all, I would like to clarify that this shift is a long-term journey and it can take 3 to 5 years. It cannot happen overnight. It has to be a journey because we need to raise awareness about the importance of the IPSAS standards and the importance of accruals. Then we have to train all the public workforce working in public entities about using the IPSAS. And we need to raise the awareness of public servants about the fact that implementing the IPSAS doesn't mean that we are ditching those employees. We are going to train them on those standards. And moving from cash to accruals need to be done in a phased manner and needs to be adopted by the government with all its capacities. And we need some international entities that have enough experience and in those phases, such as the World Bank, the IFAC, and other financial consultants who have worked and supported the countries in moving from cash to accruals. Thank you.
Thank you very much. There was a question about how to work on public financial management reform, including accounting standards and reporting in fragile countries, such as Syria,
Lebanon, Yemen. I don't know, Jamal, if we can include West Bank Gaza, but if not fragile, then at least very, very complicated. Rajat, would you like to share the World Bank's experience and maybe Jamal, your experience too? Is there anything in these more complicated settings? Are there any lessons we can learn relevant to the issue of the topic today? This region obviously is a very diverse one with the middle income countries in conflict together with very high income countries. And so it is something that occupies a lot of people in the countries and also those advising them. So Rajat, do you want to share? And then maybe Jamal, you can share your experience as well. Thank you.
Thanks, Ian. So there has been some engagement with Lebanon over moving to accrual system of accounting. And it's very early stages right now. There have been discussions, training programs, awareness raising programs for the SAIE, for Ministry of Finance. And there has been some discussion there underway. West Bank and Gaza also, the World Bank has been working with the PAO as well as the government in terms of promoting accrual-based system of accounting. But I mean, it's again in initial stages of discussion. I think the it relates with the whole debate on cash versus accrual and when a country is ready to move. So I think it's each country has its own journey and there is no one size fits all solution to this. So I depending on where, what's the starting point here, path has to be chosen and you know, taken on a sustain. I think the thing to remember is that these are long-term reforms. And I think that understanding has to be accepted and understood by everyone right at the beginning of the reform.
Thank you, Rajat. Jamal?
Ashkarik. Ihna andana fi Palestine.
Thank you, Jens. In Palestine, as you mentioned, due to the lack of stability, political stability in certain regions and the lack of control over all the Palestinian territories for political reasons, we have real operational challenges that are reflected in the implementation by the central or local governments of developments for their systems, although some initiatives have been successful. So the success that has been achieved in Palestine in a number of local institutions of the public sector. So some public entities have set plans for moving from cash to accruals and have actually implemented those plans. For example, local government entities, local municipalities in certain provinces, some ministries, so some public entities have succeeded in implementing the accruals, and the World Bank and the various regulators such as the World Bank and other public audit entities have played a role in supervising the accounting programs in the public sector. So my answer is yes, there are some success stories from the public sectors, but we need to have this success in the whole public sector, not just in certain areas of the public sector. So this requires the collaboration between the Ministry of Finance, the State Audit Bureau, and the Syndicate of Accountants. And we have participated in the aforementioned index in moving from cash to accruals. In the framework of the 2025 or 2030 plan. Thank you.
Thank you, Jamal. It seems from the QA that we should have a follow-up session on cash to accrual in MENA. It is a never-ending topic which has entertained many careers across the world. So maybe I could extend an invitation to the co-organizers to have a follow-up breakout session on that. It's good to see that we also have a few other development partners join. We have Rajesh Kishan from DFID. I believe DFID is now DFAT, but I may be mistaken. Maybe it's DFID again, I don't know. But he's asking, should PAOs be collaborating with other civil society actors, particularly beyond the profession, to advocate for greater fiscal accountability and transparency, and to engage in the design and monitoring of PFM reform programs? If yes, are there any examples or guidance to support this? And Jamal, I think you mentioned the need to work with stakeholders within the profession, but the question here is about, I guess, civil society more broadly. Anyone would like to come in here, maybe from IFAC or World Bank or from the region?
نعم.
Alex,
ممكن أن أعقب ببساطة بشكل بسيط حول رؤية.
I can comment quickly about our vision in this regard. Any PAO, such as an organization or a syndicate, has a responsibility toward the community in increasing transparency and engagement. So the PAO is responsible for communicating with the business community or with the local community on all levels in order to promote the positive spirit of transparency in accordance with international standards and promoting the transparency and publishing information for the public. This increases the transparency and increases public supervision and accountability. And this puts decision makers and governments under pressure in order to spare no effort in order to provide the public services of a high quality. So I think this is a very good question, and the answer is yes. And we need continuous dialogue in order to find the aspects on which we can contribute with the local community.
Excellent, thank you so much. I should see what Jess just confirmed that it is not DFID or DFAT, but FCDO. So I guess that's an abbreviation coming our way. Could I suggest that before my brief closing remarks, we hear on the same topic from Alex, who raised his hand, but also from Hatem to provide the AFAA perspective on that question, and any closing remarks you may want to share before I close this very active session. So Alex and then Hatem.
Excellent, thank you very much, Yen. So I think a really good question that's come through from, if I get the acronym right, FCDO as the new amalgamation in the UK. And from our perspective at ACCA, we see civil society as a critical user of public sector financial reporting and the financial statements. So very often when we think about the work that we undertake, and I'd encourage us of other PAOs too, in actually shaping the standards and responding to the IPSAS board and thinking about the future of public sector accounting standards, is to think about users and how we actually make the full use of financial statements. And part of what we're actually doing with ACCA at the moment is running a pilot in the Caribbean, which is a campaign with members around anti-corruption and professional ethics. One facet of that we're considering is actually making use of our certificate in public financial management and bringing that to journalists at either low cost or none to help with facilitating that, that oversight role and improving the ability of civil society to provide that scrutiny. So I think there's definitely things that PAOs can do in this space. Maybe the one other thing that I'd say, Jens, just to close off from my perspective, is I'd very much, there was a question in there around SAIs, around Supreme Audit Institutions. And I think it's great that we've talked about the transition to accrual, such an important area, but I see the role of SAI as so critical, actually, as we navigate our way to the other side of the pandemic. And there is actually a piece that we've completed with INTSAI, the International Organization for Supreme Audit Institutions, the development arm of that, the INTSAI DI, that's available in English and Arabic, looking at a number of policy briefs. So I might share that with Donna after, if we're able to circulate that, looking at areas like public procurement, transparency of spending, and leaving no one behind. So I think I'm really, maybe another follow-up for us, Jens, alongside accrual, would be the role of SAIs.
Excellent, looking forward to the series. I should recognize Laura has been a key in organizing this. Laura, would you like to come in briefly before we go to Hatem? Sorry, Hatem, but...
No, that's fine. And just this has been extremely valuable event and very useful for everyone. I think it's encouraging to see how much interaction there has been in the Q&A. And I think there's a lot for us to take back to IFAC as kind of follow up actions coming out of this. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Laura. Hatem.
Yeah, thank you, Jens. Actually, I would like to share my closing points. Firstly, I would like, let me switch to Arabic.
At the end, I can only thank all the colleagues, our support teams from the IFAC, the World Bank, and the AFAA, and my colleague Jamal Milhem mentioned their names at the beginning, and I would like to thank Dana, Vanessa, Noor Kotob, our interpreter, and our colleagues from the World Bank and from AFAA, Dr. Farid, and all the workers. And our colleague Jamal Milhem for his continuous support to the Arab Federation of Accountants and Auditors. And I think that this discussion has been very enriching, and through the questions that were asked, I reiterate what Jens said regarding the need for organizing subsequent webinars about the importance of moving from cash to accruals and adopting and implementing the IPSAS standards. Clearly, many participants are thirsty for more information in this regard, and our region, our Arab world, need greater support from all the international organizations in moving from cash to accruals, given the great benefits of this move. And this was explained by all our competent speakers. I think it's our responsibility as Arab Federation of Accountants and Auditors to stay in touch with all the PAOs, with all the international organizations, such as the World Bank, the ACCAs, and all the Arab organizations through workshops, conferences, research, which promotes the role of these PAOs in supporting the local communities and improving the PFM in all the jurisdictions. I think that our meeting was very successful, and I hope that we will have many more conferences and meetings in the future. And thank you very much.
Thank you so much. We have 5 minutes left and need to close on time because we are the accountancy profession here. So I'll do it very quickly. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers in IFAC or co-organizers in IFAC and the Arab Federation of Accountants, in particular Hatem for your leadership, Dana Jensen of IFAC, Vanessa McGinley, IFAC, Darlene Nazaruba, and obviously also our interpreter Noor, who's done a very good job. Thank you for so making this this event seamlessly implemented. I also personally welcome the partnership between AFAA, IFAC, and the World Bank Group in MENA, and I really do hope that we can leverage each of our strengths to the benefit of the peoples and the counterparts and clients in our countries. And then obviously a warm thank to the panel members, Hatem, Kawasmy, Jamal, Milhem, Alex, Metcalf, and Laura Leka. I think it was a very informative. Briefly, we learned about the centrality of PFM reform, the role of POAs in the post-COVID recovery period. And I would add, as the pandemic continues, we learned from Laura about all the support that's available from IFAC, whether cash is still king to implementation support. And I think many of the questions that came in the chat were actually responded to what is available on the IFAC website. We heard from Rajat Narula about the strong support to accrual accounting provided by the World Bank, but also the lessons, the need to work with broader stakeholder groups and raising awareness. And I think if there are two or three cross-cutting issues that are coming up, it is this need to work with different stakeholders, not just ourselves, the need to embed accounting reforms, reporting reforms in wider reform areas, and the centrality of the elected bodies, legislatures, or equivalent. Jamal Milhem shared, I think, very insightful experiences from PAOs in the region, their role, their function, and how they can be instrumental in moving the agenda forward. And the QA, I think it's more a note to self in IFAC and AFAA and the World Bank. Strong questions around implementation support. How do we do this? It's not a question, should we, but how do we? Related, how do we work the political economy, overcome resistance? Related, how do we share the cost-benefit ratio of doing this? Related, how do we support countries to become members in the professional organizations? How do we work in fragile settings, again, an implementation setting? And then the perennial cash accrual conversation, which will probably continue until I retire in 2037. So with that, thank you so much to everyone who joined. Looking forward to meeting all of you either on a screen or in person as I'm moving to Cairo on Saturday. So looking forward to it. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.
Thank you.